Welcome to this audio slide on the streams of finance. My name is Manfred Frühwirth. I'm professor of finance at WU Wien, which is Vienna University of Economics and Business. The purpose of this audio slide is to illustrate the structure of finance and especially to show the differences between the various streams of finance. First of all, defining finance with a very wide horizon, we have to distinguish between standard finance and behavioral finance. I will come to the differences between these two streams later. Standard finance can be further subdivided into neoclassical finance and neo-institutional finance. The oldest stream of finance is definitely neoclassical finance. In neoclassical finance, to facilitate things, you are working in a very simple and idealized model setting. Especially, you assume a perfect capital market. The assumption of a perfect capital market includes several assumptions. First, everybody has equal and free access to the capital market, so there are no capital market restrictions. Second, there are no transaction costs. Third, all securities are perfectly divisible. So, for instance, you can buy 1.13 stocks. Fourth, there is a perfect competition on the capital market. Therefore, all market participants are so-called price takers. This means that nobody can influence the security prices with his orders. Another assumption, within the assumption of a perfect capital market, is that there are no taxes. The final assumption is that everybody has the same information, so there's full transparency on the capital market. This is called the homogeneous information assumption. The neoclassical models argue based on supply, demand, and market price, as well as the no arbitrage condition. As a result, in these models, everything is nice and easy to handle. The neoclassical stream of finance is very powerful. Due to the simplicity of the models, you can get very clear and often intuitive results. Most of the basic models that have been derived in finance are situated within this stream of finance. For instance, one very popular concept within neoclassical finance is the concept of efficient capital markets. On an efficient capital market, for each security, the market price equals its fundamental value. One very prominent model in the neoclassical finance world is the capital asset pricing model, short CAPM. The problem with neoclassical finance is that the assumptions listed before are very strong and extremely unrealistic. To provide a few examples, access to the capital market is definitely not equal, but easier for big players than for small retail investors. Also, in practice, there are transaction costs. For instance, when you are buying or selling a security, there is a bid-ask spread. In addition, securities are not perfectly divisible. And clearly, if big market players buy or sell huge volumes of securities, this has an impact on the price. This contradicts the assumption of perfect competition on the capital market. Also, clearly in reality, we have to pay taxes. And finally, often in practice, we have situations with asymmetric information. For instance, among the stock market participants, there are often investors that have information earlier than the others. These are called insiders. To illustrate the frontiers of neoclassical finance, due to the strong and unrealistic assumptions, Neoclassical finance is not able to explain why in reality there are banks and insurance companies and why there is any regulation. If the neoclassical model world was reality, these institutions would not be necessary. They would only generate costs without bringing any benefit. For instance, the services of banks and insurance companies could be bought on the market easily and cheaper. And the market would not require any regulation, but market prices would regulate everything. In spite of these problems, the neoclassical finance framework is very important because it builds a sound foundation on which to develop more elaborated models. Because of the deviations between the neoclassical assumptions and reality, researchers in finance in a first step added a second stream of standard finance, namely neo-institutional finance. In this stream, you relieve the assumption of a perfect capital market. To put it differently, you allow for capital market imperfections. For instance, these models include taxes, transaction costs, short selling constraints, or asymmetric information. Asymmetric information means that different parties have different levels of information. As a result, so-called principal-agent problems may occur. In this framework, the principal hires an agent to work for him. If the agent has more information than the principal, it may happen that the agent does not work in the interest of the principal, but rather in his own interest. Neoclassical finance and neo-institutional finance together can be comprehended under the umbrella term standard finance. But with the extension from neoclassical finance to standard finance, the path of finance was not finished yet. In the past decades, several researchers added a third stream, namely behavioral finance. The difference between standard finance and behavioral finance is easily explained. In both streams of standard finance, you assume that everybody is rational. This holds both for the investors on the capital market, including parties that are supporting them, and for people within the companies. Technically, rationality means that people are maximizing their own expected utility. In contrast to standard finance, in behavioral finance, you allow for irrational behavior. Therefore, people are subject to biases like overconfidence, loss aversion, or regret, and they use heuristics like uncritically following the herd. This irrational behavior can occur, for instance, on the capital market or within the company. Irrationality on the capital market may include the irrationality of stockholders, bondholders, banks, or parties that are supporting the investors, like analysts or rating agencies. Irrationality within the firm may especially come from the managers. Over the past decades, empirical research has produced substantial evidence that people act irrationally. Researchers like Professor Stedman from Santa Clara University illustrated this with the statement, "People in standard finance are rational, people in behavioral finance are normal." By allowing for irrational behavior of people, behavioral finance can explain several puzzles that cannot be sufficiently understood within standard finance. One of these puzzles is why investors on the stock market sell winning stocks too early and losing stocks too late, as shown empirically. Another phenomenon inconsistent with standard finance, but explained by behavioral finance, is the excessive volatility that you can observe on the stock market and with other types of securities. Behavioral finance can also provide explanations why retail investors rather buy stocks at high prices in a bubble and sell stocks at low prices in the middle of a crash. Another puzzle that can be better understood in a behavioral finance setting is the so-called home bias. This means that investors often allocate too much of their capital to stocks of companies that are located in the same country. Of course, all these empirical findings have strongly raised the importance of behavioral finance in the past years. Summing up, this audio slide should give you a good overview how to structure the field of finance. Altogether, there are three different streams of finance: neoclassical finance and neo-institutional finance, both streams within the umbrella term standard finance, as well as behavioral finance. Moreover, we saw the differences between these streams with respect to their assumptions. Thereby, we could see the path that research in finance has taken over the past decades. This path started in a very simplified world, namely neoclassical finance, to generate the basic findings. Based on that, the next job was the fine-tuning. This required to include more and more sophistications to bring the models closer to reality. First, researchers added market imperfections. This was done by the models of neo-institutional finance. In the second step, researchers added irrationality, which paved the way for behavioral finance. Altogether, this wide horizon of finance provides many helpful tools to explain a lot of phenomena that we can observe in practice. I hope that you enjoyed this audio slide. Thank you very much for watching.